December 14th, Daily Video Bible Reading from the Net Bible, Jonah chapters 3 and 4 from the Old Testament. The Lord said to Jonah a second time, "Go immediately to Nineveh, that large city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah went immediately to Nineveh, as the Lord had said. Now Nineveh was an enormous city. It required 3 days to walk through it. When Jonah began to enter the city 1 day's walk, he announced, "At the end of 40 days, Nineveh will be overthrown." The people of Nineveh believed in God, and they declared a fast and put on sackcloth, from the greatest to the least of them. When the news reached the king of Nineveh, he got up from his throne, took off his royal robe, put on sackcloth, and sat on ashes. He issued a proclamation and said, "In Nineveh, by the decree of the king and his nobles, no human or animal, cattle or sheep, is to taste anything. They must not eat and they must not drink water. Every person and animal must put on sackcloth and must cry earnestly to God, and everyone must turn from their evil way of living and from the violence that they do. Who knows, perhaps God might be willing to change his mind and relent and turn from his fierce anger so that we might not die." When God saw their actions, they turned from their evil way of living. God relented concerning the judgment he had threatened them with, and he did not destroy them. This displeased Jonah terribly, and he became very angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, "O Lord, this is just what I thought would happen when I was in my own country. This is what I tried to prevent from attempting to escape to Tarshish, because I knew that you are gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in mercy, and one who relents concerning threatened judgment. So now, Lord, kill me instead, because I would rather die than live." The Lord said, "Are you really so very angry?" Jonah left the city and sat down east of it. He made a shelter for himself there and sat down under it in the shade to see what would happen to the city. The Lord God appointed a little plant and caused it to grow up over Jonah to be a shade over his head to rescue him from his misery. Now Jonah was very delighted about the little plant. So God sent a worm at dawn the next day, and it attacked the little plant so that it dried up. When the sun began to shine, God sent a hot east wind, so the sun beat down on Jonah's head and he grew faint. So he despaired of life and said, "I would rather die than live." God said to Jonah, "Are you really so very angry about the little plant?" And he said, "I am as angry as I could possibly be." The Lord said, "You were upset about this little plant, something for which you have not worked, nor did you do anything to make it grow. It grew up overnight and died the next day. Should I not be even more concerned about Nineveh, this enormous city? There are more than 120,000 people in it who do not know right from wrong, as well as many animals." God, what are we going to do with Jonah? Especially since he's so much like me. So we see Jonah getting parts of it in the first couple chapters of Jonah, where he praised you for saving him, even though he had been swallowed by a fish. And we even see him being obedient at the beginning of this part of the story, where he goes directly to Nineveh and does exactly what you tell him to do. Yet there's this odd thing that happens. He goes there under kind of an umbrella of righteousness and proclaims on your behalf that Nineveh will be destroyed. And Nineveh believes in you and takes it to heart and goes into fasting and mourning. We even see for the third time the pagans cry out and wonder if they could possibly be saved by you. Now, we haven't seen Jonah cry out for them. Not when they were in the boat being batted around by the storm and the sea. And not now. He is simply being obedient to what you ask him to do. But again, I think out of a little bit of ego. And after seeing their change of heart through their actions, you change your mind and decide to not destroy Nineveh. And now Jonah's mad. I've been this way before. I know people who read Jonah, this part of Jonah, are like, oh, how could he be so rude to the pagans? How could he do? Yeah, I've done this before. When I've done the right thing for the right reasons, but my heart wasn't in the right place. And that was Jonah. And so he goes up to pout a little bit up on a hill and hopefully watch God change his mind again, right? And actually destroy the city. And you send a plant that with large leaves to provide him shade. And Jonah's absolutely delighted by this little plant. And then you send a worm to destroy the plant. And then you send the sun to beat down on his head and cause him to grow faint, probably from heat exposure. And he keeps getting madder and angrier and wanting to die. And your point to him as we end this story abruptly so that we can kind of finish the story in our head is, you have so much compassion for yourself. You were good being saved out there in the storm. You absolutely love this plant that has nothing to do with anything. Yet you have no compassion. You have no love for these people who are lost, who don't know their right hand from their left hand. Jonah, at one point you were like that. At one point you didn't know your right hand from your left hand. And now you have no compassion for these people. And not only should you have compassion, but you should be rejoicing that they had repentance in their heart and they changed the way that they were living. But you didn't. You threw a huge tantrum and made it all about you. And the making it all about you, I'm really good at. I've always been really good at. And it's something that you and I have always worked on, God. Because it's so easy to make it about ourselves and forget all of the other people in this world, all of your people in this world, and think that we should be treated differently somehow because we're your children, that we should be treated differently than the rest of the world. God, I ask that you bring balance to my heart. I ask that you show me clearly how to love everyone with the love that you have for me and the love that you put inside of me. Allow my compassion to overflow like yours does in my life. Allow my patience to always be there as people learn at different paces, understand in different ways, and develop according to your timeline. God, help me keep it foremost in my head and my heart. It is all about you. It's all about your plan. It's all about your glory and your kingdom. It's not about me. I might as well be that little worm in the story that goes and eats the plant. God, I want to be excited for the pagans of this world, that they hear your word. I want to rejoice when there's a heart change in them. And I want my heart to break until that moment happens for them. God, help me to always see everybody else around me for who they truly are, instead of always looking inside of me. I pray all this in your son's name. Amen.